In my fourth talk on mystical theology, I would like to look at St. Gregory of Nyssa. And we might give as title of this talk, Dazzling Darkness. I mentioned earlier how we may use two different symbols for the encounter between the human person and the living God, the symbol of light and the symbol of darkness. Now, the people whom we've been looking at in the last two talks, Evagrius and Macarius, are both solar mystics. They think of God in terms of light. But St. Gregory of Nyssa, and this is his great innovation, brings back into the mainstream of Christian mystical theology the idea of divine darkness. Already, as I've mentioned, the Jewish writer Philo draws on Exodus 20:21, on the phrase, Moses entered into the deep darkness where God was. And he treats darkness as a symbol of the divine incomprehensibility, the unfathomable mystery of God. Clement continues this. In the late 2nd and early 3rd century, but then, for a time, the symbol of divine darkness is not found in the leading mystical authors and writers on the spiritual life. Origen, Gregory of Nazianzus, along with Evagrius and Macarius, are all of them light mystics. But Gregory of Nyssa brings back the divine darkness and sets it in the center of his spiritual teaching. Clearly, the symbol of darkness can be used in different ways. First of all, darkness can be seen as a negative symbol. We speak of the darkness of sin, the darkness of ignorance. Clearly, in this pejorative sense, darkness is not applicable to God. And doubtless it is in this sense that St. John says, God is light and in him is no darkness at all. Then, at a second level, darkness can be seen as a symbol of purging and purification. This is the way in which the darkness symbol is used, for example, in the Western Carmelite author St. John of the Cross. He speaks of the darkness of the senses and of the spirit, the dark night of the soul. And this signifies for John of the Cross the purging, the purification that we have to undergo in order to approach God. Exactly, the dark night in John of the Cross represents the laying aside of images of which Evagrius speaks. But then there is a third sense in which the symbol of darkness may be employed, where it signifies not just purging and purification, but union. And John of the Cross also uses darkness in this sense. Not just as purification, but as a symbol of our meeting with God, our union with him in love. So here we have the highest level of the darkness symbolism, where it represents not our sinfulness, not our need to be purified, but the mystery of God himself. And it is in this third sense that Gregory chiefly uses the symbol of darkness. First of all, a few words about the life of St. Gregory of Nyssa. Let us once again make the personal connection. He was born around 335, and he died soon after 394. He was the younger brother of Basil the Great. In fact, there were a number of others in the family, but we need not speak of them now. Basil, early in his life, soon after his university studies, firmly adopts the monastic path. But his younger brother Gregory followed a different way. Initially, he embarked on a secular career, becoming a rhetor, a rhetorician, which means he probably taught rhetoric, how to make effective speeches. But it probably also means that he had a legal training and would have pleaded in court. At any rate, he is following a civil career initially. And he married. Most of the fathers were not married. They were monastics. So it's rather precious to find a father who was a married man. The name of St. Gregory's wife, as far as we can discover, was St. Theosavia. Basil, his older brother, when he became Archbishop of Caesarea, the chief city in Cappadocia, was deeply involved in the struggle against Arianism, against the heresy which made Christ less than God, which regarded him as a created being. And in order to gain support in his struggle against Arianism, Basil insists to his younger brother Gregory that he should be ordained bishop. He also has his friend Gregory of Nazianzus consecrated as bishop. Neither of them seem to have been particularly enthusiastic about this, but Basil was a person of strong character, and he got his way. Gregory, from that point on, seems to have lived with his wife as brother and sister. She became a deaconess, but she continued to look after him. They didn't actually have any children. After Basil's death in 379, it is his younger brother Gregory who assumes leadership in the struggle against the Arians, because after 381, Gregory of Nazianzus also entered into retirement. And so Gregory, who at the beginning of his life was not particularly an ecclesiastical figure, ends up by being very much at the heart of the church struggle in favor of the truth. In his later years, Gregory writes two works that are of particular significance: a mystical commentary on the Song of Songs, which he interprets as a story of the human soul in union with Christ the Bridegroom. And then a symbolical interpretation of the life of Moses. And he sees Moses in his life as being a paradigm, an example of the human person in quest of union with God.